rush on ahead in my own strength when you're right here. Lord, I don't want to rush on ahead in my own strength when you're right here. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your knees.
Welcome to Quarry Church. My name is Adam Rosanis. It's good to see you on this beautiful, sunny Sunday morning. If you're with us online, we're glad that you're joining us from wherever you are as well. As I got dressed this morning, I threw on a shirt that I haven't worn in a while, but it brings back some memories. I picked this up in Georgia last summer on a family vacation. My parents rented a beautiful cabin in the northern mountains of northern Georgia. And one day while we were there, we decided we wanted to go tubing in a town called Helen. Now, Helen is to Georgia what the Wisconsin Dells are to Wisconsin. very obscure, wonderfully bizarre tourist trap. And the folks there have learned how to capitalize on every opportunity, including tubing on a stream that's not really meant for tubing. We got there, and it was too shallow. We're scraping our bottoms on rocks. At times, we had to get up and walk with our tubes. My tube popped. My sister's tube also popped. She floated half the river on her husband's lap, which was unusual to see. The real kicker, though, was this stream goes through the town of Helen, where they have built up hotels and restaurants on either side. And I have never felt more like a caged animal in a zoo. Hundreds of people are gawking at us as we tube through. Well, I'm approaching a bridge, the only bridge in town, and I see something, some liquid fall from the bridge. And I think to myself, I bet people are up there dumping stuff on tubers. Well, sure enough, as I pass under, sploosh, I just get drenched in some sort of liquid. I turn around and look up, and three grown men are up there giggling. And I said, oh, and one of them goes, oops, sorry about that. And I said, I was upset. So I said, no, you're not. You knew exactly what you were doing. And he just giggles again and goes, yeah, I did. So all that to say, I do not recommend tubing in Helen, Georgia. But I do recommend shopping at J.R. Kreider's Clothing and Apparel. Christian family-owned business makes great clothes. Hey, I'm glad you're here this morning. Here's what's going on at the Quarry. If you call the Quarry Church your home, please join us tomorrow night at 6:30 for our annual Quarry Winter Meeting. If you are currently a member of the Quarry, we want you there. We need you there. We have what we call participating membership here, which means when you become a member, it's not kind of a one and done, but we renew membership each year, and that's what's going to happen tomorrow night. We will we'll talk membership. We'll kind of evaluate how we've done over the past year, and then those who feel led to will renew membership for the upcoming year. Now, what if you're not currently a member? You're invited too. We want you to know what membership here looks like, what it sounds like as we discuss it and become members. So we invite you to join us. Childcare will be provided. Snacks will be provided afterwards, so you can hang out. If you're not able to join in person, please check your email for a link to join us virtually over Zoom, 6:30 tomorrow night. Alpha kicks off this Thursday, also at 6:30 here at Quarry Church. Alpha is just a low-pressure environment. We're going to get together and dig into life's big questions, some of life's big questions, and explore the Christian faith a bit more. You know, we just came out of 21 days of prayer and fasting. Maybe you're wondering, what do I do next? What's the next step for me? How do I continue growing in my faith? Maybe you came out of those 21 days, you've got more questions and doubt than when you went into it. Alpha is for you. We got a short video here. Let's give this a watch.
We all have that person in our lives. That neighbor we pass by every day outside our homes. That coworker we see at the office 5 days a week. Or those friends we catch up with every once in a while. People we wish could know and experience the love of God. How do we share it? Where do we even start? Deep inside, we know that it'll cost us something to open up our lives and share our faith. It takes time, vulnerability, sacrifice, the risk of rejection. But this is our call, to open our lives and to share Christ with the people close to us. Because it's only through opening your life up that spaces for honest conversations are possible. Spaces where people can truly be themselves and explore the deepest parts of life with people they know and trust. That's why we're running Alpha. It's a course over several weeks where you can invite your friends to explore life's biggest questions over a meal. It's a chance for you to invite that person into an honest conversation about faith. Because when it's hard to find the moment, or the words, or the courage, you can simply invite. Alpha, who will you invite?
All right, you got a few more days to answer that question for yourself, and then we hope you'll join us this Thursday. here at the church building. Ladies, you're invited to a Bible study, a six-week study kicking off this Friday. Opportunity to continue growing in your faith, grow in relationships with other women here. Childcare will be provided for that. That meets at 9:45 Fridays. And then finally, we are excited. Not only do the 2022 Winter Olympics begin this Friday, but we kick off our own Winter Games here. Over the next 3 weeks, we'll have some Olympic guest speakers with us. Do we have video or a slide of the photos that I can introduce? All right, it's okay. Let's go right into something. All right, three guests over the next 3 weeks, and in just a minute here, Pastor Michael's going to introduce today's guest speaker. Before he does, though, I'm going to invite you to stand and give a warm welcome to the people around you this morning.
For those of you guys who are joining us online, a special welcome to you guys this morning. Glad you're here with us. We have, you're in for a treat. You don't even know it, how good this is. Well, I'm probably doing that too much. I don't want to do that. Well, this is going to be really bad. That's what I'm telling you.
Horrible.
I want to introduce you to a very good friend of mine. So when I first started out in ministry, the guy who hired me, his name was Pastor Alden Kaske. Great man of God, very wise man of God. He connected me right away with Paul Bertelson, and Paul kind of took me under his wing, and I learned so much from a guy who was seasoned, who knew what he was doing, or faked it really, really well. And over the years, developed a friendship, and then I ended up working for Paul at an organization that he started called Youth Works. And Paul is a true entrepreneur. He's doing all kinds of things. Many of them for the kingdom of God. And so I wanted you guys to hear his heart. And so this morning we're going to hear his heart. I'm going to pray over him, and then I'm just going to get
thank
out
you.
Of the way.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Heavenly Father, thanks for this man. God, you're good. Mm-hmm. And you move, and you love, and you invite, and you shape us. And God, that's what we're here to do. Would you meet us in this time, Lord, wherever we're at, God? And then I ask that you would take us to a new place, God. We're here to be refined, and so I ask that you would speak through Paul. May your heart just speak right through him, Father. Bless him during this time. Bless all of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. You know, that was, I have to tell you, my favorite Olympic bobsled run. I mean, you know, absolutely my favorite, you know. I actually stayed on the sled, too, so that was great. So I have to tell you that it is really a joy and quite a pleasure to be here, because you all don't know this, but I knew you all when you were just a twinkle in the eye. That doesn't mean I knew your parents, okay? But as a church, I got a chance to see the twinkle in your pastor's eye. And as Michael said, when I met him, I was drawn to more than just his winsome smile and joy in his heart. I knew that he shared a love for Jesus, and I knew that he had a passion for the church, and that he also wanted and had a deep desire for kids to come to know Jesus and to love him and to serve him. And that kind of drew us together. And so as I was starting this organization, as Michael said, I thought, who could I ask to come be on our team? And I thought of Michael because he was such a wonderful fit. And yet in the midst of that conversation with Michael about joining, he was very honest with me. And he said, well, I do have to tell you that God has put a call in my heart, and that is to start a church, to plant a church. And I said, that's all right, Michael. Why don't you just come and join us? And if you're here for just 10, 20, 30 years, that's okay. You know, it ended up being about 18 months, but it was a wonderful 18-month period of doing ministry together. And so how exciting it is, really, to be here 20 years later and to see this twinkle of the eye, God's church. And so it truly is a blessing to be here this morning. I would love to open our time together reading a passage from John. I think you can follow along on the screen. It's going to be up there. It's John 13. And my guess is you've heard this passage before, and it's one that has really shaped me quite intimately. I'll read it to you. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." And Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." And Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." Let me just pray. Lord Jesus, I do pray that you would speak to us this morning, that you would tell us what you mean. Help us to do what you say, and give us the courage and the grace, Lord, to live like you and to follow your example in this world. I do pray this, Jesus, for all of us, and in your name, amen. Well, it was a blistering blast furnace of a day. a raging 115 degrees in the shade, not that there really was any shade. Not a breath of a breeze to offer any relief. Just the beating down, the relentless beating down of a scorching summer sun. To make matters worse, the swirling cement dust coated their nostrils. The same dust mixed with the free-flowing sweat of their skin collected and was caking on every crease and cavity. Their hands were becoming chapped raw from the lifting of endless cement blocks. Their muscles began to groan in pain. But these kids from suburban Minnesota, they were having the time of their lives. The giggles and the girl-boy bantering belayed the fact that they never could have imagined or seen each other quite so grungy, so earthy, so, I would say, so real. And little could they have imagined what a turn their lives would take just 24 hours earlier. Having left the comfort of their teenage lives in suburban America and now doing mission service with the destitute poor, a world away in Juarez, Mexico. And what a joy it was to join them. As we headed back to the housing after a long day of labor, our church hosts invited us to join them in a special worship service that night. With little time to spare just before the start of the service, we scarfed down a quick dinner in order to join our Mexican friends. No need to clean up, they assured us. We would be warmly welcomed. And yes, we did, pardon their pun. And we were welcomed, just as we were. And we didn't have to go far. You see, our housing did double duty as the church building. No problem with being on time, I guess. As church members gathered, we became painfully aware that we were, I don't know how to exactly say it, but we were underdressed. Embarrassed by the fact that our Mexican friends came in their proverbial Sunday best. Clothes bright and clean, bathed and fresh, ready for worship. All except for one. This one tall Mexican man stood out from all of the rest. His hair disheveled, looking like a bird's nest. Scuffly, unshaven, wearing an ill-fitted, rumpled suit coat. A whiff of his unfriendly body odor overwhelmed us. His off-centered smile and displayed yellow teeth that had never known a toothbrush. It became clear that our friend was also cognitively challenged. The service began with our tall friend sitting all by himself in the back of the room. After a lively 2-hour-plus service came to a conclusion, we were surprised by an encore experience. Something I guess I had never quite experienced in a church worship before. The pastor brought a chair forward and invited one of the church members to come and to sit. Once seated, the pastor knelt down in front of the woman and uncovered a basin of water. Carefully and oh so gently, he took off the woman's shoes and he washed her feet. Then the woman stood up and exchanged places with the pastor and washed his feet. Then others came forward. One after another, they came forward, washing each other's feet. They all came forward, all except for one. Then all of a sudden, our tall Mexican friend stood up and lumbered toward the front of the church and that chair. And he sat down. And I couldn't help but wonder, with somewhat anxious suspense, who's going to wash his feet? Who would ever consider doing such a thing? My guess is Jesus' disciples asked a similar question in that upper room on their last night together. You see, it was customary for a host, a good host, to supply a servant, to to tend to the guests' feet upon their arrival. You see, in ancient Israel, byways and highways were primarily dirt roadways traveled by all sorts of creatures. And every kind of creature that traveled along with humans experienced, well, I guess you'd call it nature's calling, leaving waste right there mixed in with the dusty roads. This wasn't just dirty dirt on their feet. The best way to describe it was dung dirt. I don't have to create too much of a visual picture for you to imagine what a sandal-clad disciple's feet looked like, and even worse, smelled like in the close of a day. You can imagine the wafting aroma of unwashed feet in the reclining head-to-feet arrangement around a low-rise meal table. For everyone's benefit, the practice of foot washing was a critical cleansing. The question of who was going to wash feet in absence of the customary slave was pushed aside by the disciples' dispute that took precedence. In the midst of that stalled-out service, considering themselves too great to bow down and belittle themselves, feet were forgotten. So enter Jesus. In these last moments together, Jesus desired to lovingly set the record straight. John says this in his gospel, having loved them to the end, Jesus wanted to show his disciples the full extent of his love. Full extent. What was that? What could that possibly look like? Especially after he had already loved them so well. John continues, he says, Jesus knew the Father had come, had put all things under his power, and he had come from the Father and was returning to the Father. John in his gospel inserts a strange little word. In English, it's so. So Jesus got up in nothing but the loincloth of a slave and wrapped a towel around his waist, poured water in a basin, and began to wash his disciples' feet. Why the so? Only a person who is truly secure in their identity can afford to take on the role of a servant. Jesus, you see, knew who he was. Nothing could diminish himself by humiliating himself, washing the feet of others. So one by one, he placed their feet in the basin, lovingly pouring water over their feet to cleanse them. But Peter was shocked. Never, he said, never will you wash my feet, he exclaimed. An act so completely inappropriate, Peter thought. The one he called Lord, serving him like a slave? No way. Peter didn't get it, as usual. The power of the example of servanthood. Jesus pointed out to Peter that he must wash his feet to make him acceptable for the kingdom of God. Do you understand what I have done for you? Jesus explains. If Jesus, their Lord, could stoop to serve the disciples, they should not compete for greatness, but rather concentrate on servanthood. He said, I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. So why? Why did Jesus offer these last words, and more importantly, this last act in the company of his disciples? Well, Jesus knew that time was short. Jesus was moved by overwhelming love for his disciples. Jesus knew that the evil one was bringing about a crisis. Jesus knew that he had come from the Father and he was going to the Father. And Jesus longed for these last words to be lasting words. And Jesus, I guess, asks us the same question. Do you know what I have done for you? Do you? Corey friends, do you understand the magnitude of Jesus' love for you? Do you? Do you see the scandalous nature of his immeasurable love for you? Do you? Do you know how crazy in love our Lord is with you, each of you? Do you? If so, what is our response? What is your response? Maybe it's the same thing he told his disciples in that upper room. He said to them, "Do as I have done to you." Quite simply, serve others. In my name, serve, he says. So let me expand on why we serve as followers in this way of Jesus. Here are 10 ways, 10 reasons why we ought to consider serving others. Number one, serving demonstrates obedience. It demonstrates obedience. For those who call themselves followers of Jesus, maybe this one reason is the only one we really need. Quite simply, we serve because Jesus said so. The motivation to obey, though, is born out of love. The love of Jesus that clearly loved us first. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." Our loving obedience responds to his first love. Serving is not a compassion, but a trusting, loving response to the undying love of our Lord. Number two, serving helps us become more like Jesus. It does. It helps us become more like Jesus. Jesus succinctly summarizes his purpose in Matthew 20, 28. "Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." You see, serving helps us become more like Jesus. When serving becomes part of our spiritual DNA, it matches Christ. The writer of Acts tells us that early members of the church were called Christians. The interesting thing is, they didn't call themselves Christians because they didn't give them that name. No, it was because others saw their lives of loving service and called them Christians or little Christ, because they emulated the life and the service of Jesus. They looked like Jesus. And so can we when we serve others. Number three, serving shows the world whose we are. Whose we are. Here's the paradox, okay? People genuinely seem to be drawn to and like Jesus. However, non-Christians are oftentimes not fond of his followers. And it's not difficult to understand why. It's called hypocrisy, judging, lack of love. Those things that confuse people and make them question. Is there really a connection between whose those folks profess to be and whose they are? Serving others generously without hesitation or conditions points to Jesus, in whose name we serve. So here's a crazy thought. People may not remember the rock-solid name of your church, little pun there, but wouldn't it be something if this community around you was so taken by your selfless serving that they would refer to you as that serving church down the road? Wouldn't that be cool? Number four, serving demonstrates the love of God in us. It demonstrates the love of God is in us. The world desires so desperately to see what real love looks like. 1 John directs us to the truth. It says this: "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us." And it doesn't end there. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. True love, real love, life-giving love looks like this. When we serve like Jesus, his love will be ever-present evidence that his love is in us. Number five, serving breaks down walls and builds up compassion. breaks down walls and builds up compassion. In the pre-COVID days, if you remember that, actually 2,000 years ago, was filled with plagues and disease. And Jesus was on a mission to break down walls. When we enter another person's world by serving them, our prejudices and preconceptions wither. When we enter into another's story, another's reality, another's pain by serving them, our own hearts soften and connects us to the deepest, our deepest mutual needs, and that is to be known and to be loved. So when we serve with and even suffer with others, walls come down and true relationships are built up. Here's the truth, friends. This is a tough one. When our hands are busy washing feet, serving others, it's really difficult to throw stones. Number 6, serving fills gaps. It fills gaps. Gaps are everywhere. Financial, emotional, relational, spiritual. We all got gaps. Our flesh-oriented human condition feasts on anything that might feed our gaping hungers. The world's belief in scarcity, unfortunately, fills our souls with fear. When we release our white-knuckled grip on our time and on our talents and our resources into selfless service, we are freed from fear and filled with faith. Filled up with evidence that our God is a God of abundance and desires us to partake in the delivery of plenty. Filling gaps, you see, may mean developing kind of a need radar, an antenna to receive the clues of the need of people around us. Growing eyes to see and ears to hear the often silent screams of pain of those near and present around us move us. It moves us to use our hands to help. Number 7, serving helps us get comfortable being uncomfortable. I read this interesting statistic. I'm a bit of a statistic nerd, and it was a study that was done on people who attended church, just like us. They found that if you took all the people who ever fell asleep in church, imagine that, all the people that ever fell asleep in church, and laid them end to end, they'd probably be a whole lot more comfortable. You see, comfort has a way of seemingly satisfying us with the current situation of life. The thought of being uncomfortable often holds us back from serving. Serving, though, can disrupt our status quo and irritate our sense of sinful equilibrium. Holy discomfort can be a God-given grace that, if listened to and responded to, can lead us and move us into the exhilarating adventure of faithful service that we can hardly fathom, bringing us something we crave, something we all crave, which is true satisfaction. Number 8, serving remembers the poor. It remembers the poor. The Bible talks a lot about the poor. There are over 2,000 verses that reference the poor. Paul reminded the church in Galatia to be about the heart of God and to remember the poor. Now, it's true, to remember means to be aware and to recognize the poor. More righteously, it means to respond. Jesus declared his fulfillment in prophecy. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor." You see, when we serve the poor, those in bondage of any kind, in any kind of oppression, anyone needing to be set free, we can join Jesus in becoming the good news that he refers to. Number 9, serving builds the church. It builds the church. Here's the truth, friends. Our pastor's primary work is not to minister to us. No, that is not Pastor Michael's primary work, at least according to Scripture. No, the Apostle Paul tells us that quite clearly in his letter to the Ephesians, our pastors and teachers are to equip the saints for service. That's you and that's me. And for what reason? So that the body of Christ, his church, Scripture says, may be built up. For what ultimately is the purpose? Attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So Quarry Church, guess what happens when you serve together in supporting refugee families? When you gather up food for hungry families in your community? When you labor in love to house the chronically homeless? Guess what? The beautiful Church of Christ gets built up. And lastly, number 10, serving brings joy to our lives. It brings joy. Jesus could not be more clear when he tells his disciples this. He said, "If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." Think about it. Jesus didn't tell his disciples to serve each other to be a killjoy. Just the opposite. He knew what indescribable joy would be ours when we served like Jesus. It was for our good, for our joy. You see, the sweetness of his joy can be our joy. And that joy is the high-octane fuel for even greater service. So 10 great reasons to serve. And I don't know about you, but for me, the bottom line kind of boils down to this. And it's the same question that I asked myself that sweltering hot night in Mexico. That haunting question. Who would wash his feet? Who would wash his feet? I surely couldn't that night in Mexico. I was too much of a mess myself. Too tired, too dirty, too disgusting. My sin certainly stopped me. But a wonderful thing happened that night. A Holy Spirit thing. You see, the Holy Spirit moved a man's selfish legs and motivated his hard heart to walk in the direction of his Mexican brother. As that man knelt before him and removed his brother's broken leather shoes, revealing his sockless, even more leathered feet, his hands quivered. With trepidation, the man picked up the brother's feet and gently placed them into the basin. And as tears became a river flowing down my cheeks, splashing onto my brother's feet, the same holy tears washed my feet. Tears of cleansing, tears of joy. And what a joy it was to wash the feet of Jesus. Because it couldn't be any more true, my Quarry friends, that when you do it to the least of these, when you do it to the least of these, let me pray. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for this beautiful picture of love that you have painted for us. Thank you even more for leading us into loving others through serving selflessly. Help us to pray, Jesus, to be more like you. In doing so, we can become your serving church. Let it be so. Let it be so. Amen.
So we're gonna respond to that. So kind of how we do this at the quarry. If this is new to you, we kind of reverse things. A lot of times you'll come to a church and you'll sing together, and then there will be a message. We like to reverse that. We want you to hear a message and then respond out of that. What is it to serve Jesus, to love Jesus? And Paul, that's why I asked you to come, because this isn't something that is theoretical for you, but you've lived it out and you've exemplified that to so many. But what does it look like for us, church, in a world that is about serving self, protecting self? What does it look like for us to go into the world and to serve well? To love well, to be known as, I'm not sure what their name is, but they sure do love that church, to be known as that. So we're going to enter into a time of singing. And as those words come up, maybe you know the song, maybe you don't, but my hope is that your heart connects to those lyrics and they become yours and it becomes a prayer. Of praise and honor to our King, to the one who serves us, who loves us. Before we get there, I just want to remind you, one of the main ways that we worship at the quarry is that we give, that we're a generous people. And we do that by bringing our tithes and our offerings. Now, things have switched. Most of you guys are doing this electronically. You give online, you give via our app or the web, and I just want to thank you for that. Because you are faithful, we are able to gather. Because you are faithful, things are happening that you don't even know about. I mean, there's kids in our kids' ministry right now. There are meetings that happen during the week. There are people who are being counseled and encouraged. There's a student ministry that gathers here. Because you are faithful, and I thank you for your faithfulness. God's doing great things. So at this time, if you would, use the app, go to the website and go ahead and give. If you're more traditional and you want to write out a check, you can certainly do that. And you can give in our giving box on your way out this morning. But let me pray, and then let's stand if you can, and let's sing to our King. All right. Heavenly Father, we are blessed to be called your children. We are heirs to the King, sons and daughters. Would you stir that in us again, God? Because I think we forget that. I think we forget whose we are. And I think we live out of a whole nother nature so much of the time. But God, would you remind us who we are? And the glory that surrounds us because of who we are. Because of who you are, God. Lord, we love you. We worship you. We praise you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Waters holding back the seas. never need remind. How I've been set free. There is a cross that bears the burden. Another died for me. There is another in the fight. All my debt left a debt beneath the wall. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. I know I will never be alone. There's another in the fire standing next to me. There's another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding, power set me free. There's a grave that holds no body. Power lives in me. There's another in the fire. Oh, oh, oh. There's another in the fire.
Count the joy, come every
shadow, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. Count the joy come every night.
I've been a criminal.
stolen your breath. I sang my own song. Lord, I confess, I'm far from innocent. The shackles I wear, I bought on my own. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost, and paid my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled. Lord, I confess, I've been caught to go. Made for your house, I rip my own walls. And Jesus, tore down my prison wall. Death came to life when he called me by name. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost, and nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty sleigh at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled. We sing again. The scarlet sins had a crimson cost, and nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty sleigh at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled. Tomb where there should be a cast. The children are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Roses in bloom, pushed up from the hills. Rivers of tears flow from good times for men. Families are singing and dancing. The Father is welcoming. All heaven joins in with the glorious sound, and the great cloud of witnesses all gather round. Cause the ones that were lost are finally. You say, the Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost, debt to that old rugged cross. The empty sleigh at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was. We sing, oh. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming.
So that's what we walk out with, right? That we are saved. We are covered by the power and the glory and the resurrection of Jesus. We get to walk in that power everywhere we go, everywhere. every step we take. And so the question Paul asks, the question that Jesus leaves us with is, so who are you going to serve? As he washes your feet, as he washes your soul, as he makes you new, he's making you new with a purpose to go into the world and usher in his kingdom and bring life and love everywhere you go. So what is that going to look like today? Church, open your eyes. It's there for you. Step into it. Let the Holy Spirit raise those legs and walk you to where he wants you to be for his glory. It's awesome. All right, I'm going to pray a blessing over you. But before we go, just a reminder. All right, we have some big stuff going on this week. We have a really important meeting, and it's a family gathering. It's a celebration of what God is doing, but it's also a kind of a check, a heart check. It's like, are we living as the church? And where can we do better? So we'd love to see you tomorrow night. And then Thursday, we have Alpha that's going to be here. And friends, people need to know about Jesus. Maybe you need like a refresher course. Like, boy, I need to remember what I believe and why I believe. We're going to be here at 6:30. Go online. Go to our app. Check it out. Go to the connection table. There'll be information there. We'll be here at 6:30 on Thursday, okay? All right, let me pray. Heavenly Father, God, we delight in you. You are our King. And God, you have, in every sense of the word, you've exemplified what it is to follow you. God, would you fill us with your Spirit and bury, Lord, the spirit of fear within us, that we would have a spirit of love, a spirit of hope, a spirit of life, a spirit of courage, to live as you have called us to live, God. All for your glory. Bless us, Lord, as we step out into the world. We ask this in Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Thanks, you guys, for being here today.
Most of it.